inviting me along again to give another talk at the Melbourne Chess Club. My name's Robert Jamieson, and thank you also for coming out on such a miserable, wet and horrible night. But we love our chess, so let's get started. My topic for today is how not to attack. How not to attack. By that I mean a lot of players do attacks that probably they shouldn't do. They do bad attacks, and we need to be able to recognise the difference between a good attack and a bad attack. And if someone's doing a bad attack on us, how do we respond? Okay, let me start off with a little story. Once upon a time, there was a chess player called Marcus, rated about 1900. He woke up after a good night's sleep, feeling pretty relaxed and rested, looked out the window, it was a beautiful sunny day. He was feeling pretty good about things. And he thought to himself, tonight I'm playing Christopher Wallace at the Box Hill Chess Club. Pretty tough game, because I'm rated 1900 and Chris is about 2350. He thought to himself, I feel like attacking. I think tonight I might attack. So, let's see how he went. I'll show you the game. Marcus was white. It's a good start if you want to attack. Played knight f3. Played knight f6. Marcus played b3. A bit hypermodern, so he's grabbing the centre, so black grabs the centre. Fianchettos, pawn here, not too ambitious, pawn here, bishop here, played c4, so he's finally contesting a little bit of the centre. Black castled. Alright, how are we going so far? With black's position or white's position?
Yeah.
Well, okay. Have anyone read Cecil Purdy's article, The Openings in 10 Hours? Bill has, because he's really, really old. But Cecil Purdy is a famous Australian chess teacher. Once wrote this article about the openings in 10 hours, and his theory was he could teach a complete novice how to more or less master the openings in 10 hours. And from memory, he more or less suggested that you adopt this setup for black. And he said you could do it in virtually every opening. So against e4, this is the French defence. Against d4, it's the Tarrasch defence. You can play it as white. It's a nice solid setup. You've got your pieces out, your king's safe, you've got a pawn in the centre. That's all pretty good. So Wallace is just playing the standard nice safe setup. Anyway, right about now, Marcus remembered. Oh, that's right, today I was going to attack. So he played rook here. What do we think? Good move, bad move? Strange move, perhaps. What's his idea?
I'll let other people have a move.
Push the g-pawn.
Yeah, he's going to throw the pawns at us and hit us with a vicious attack. What should black do? White's plan is pretty clear. What do we do? Stop it with h5 or something.
Keep developing pieces.
Yeah, ignore it. If it's not a good attack, let's just ignore it, do the normal stuff. What should black do then? What would be a normal move?
Get the queen side.
Which specifically?
I know a normal move, baby.
Alright, well, you tell us a normal move.
C5.
Yes. You should get two pawns side by side in the opening if you can, to give you your active play. Now, of course, Marcus zoomed up here. Here comes the attack. Follow-up move. Let's develop our knight and see what happens. Marcus is pretty happy around here, because his pawn is zooming ahead and it's hitting the knight. So the knight comes into the centre. So now we've got three pieces attacking this pawn defender twice. So white protects it. Okay, he looks like he's making good progress with his pawns. Vicious attack coming along. What should black do to counter the attack? We've got our two pawns side by side, we've got three pieces out. What do you normally do if someone's trying to attack you on a flank?
Attack into centre.
Yeah, counter attack in the centre. All right. So what move would that be here?
D4. Yeah.
Yes. So black goes D4. So if this works, he's killed off the bishop being part of the attack, and he's going to end up with more space. But Marcus can play pawn here. Now this looks like it could be a good move, because where does the knight go? If it goes back here, which is the only safe square, this pawn's attacked three times, defended twice, we might be able to win a pawn. What can black do?
He's got a bit of a tactical move there.
So if we just retreat, we could be in strife. Do we have any other options?
Yes, we do.
You want to have a go?
Bring the queen for the attack.
Let's give him a check.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, he could move the king up. Means he can't castle. And then we have to go back. But unfortunately, he doesn't end up winning a pawn, because after takes, we have a sneaky queen check, and then we'll win this piece here. So king up probably isn't the best, so Marcus played knight back here. Any suggestions for black? A knight's still attacked. We probably have to move it somewhere.
Oh, I know where Eddie Levi would move it.
Okay. I know where Phil Viner would move it, but...
Eddie Levi always goes forward.
Yes, let's go forward. We don't want to go back. Let's go forwards here. Because this is pretty sneaky. Like, if he takes us, we take him and we've got a fork. Or if he takes what the bishop takes, we're hitting the knight. If the knight moves, we've got here, discovered check. Looks fantastic. So, Marcus wasn't perturbed though, he was still focusing on his attack. So he thought he'd bring in the high-powered pieces, queen up here. Are we terrified? Has he got a good attack?
No.
Okay. So, he's not threatening anything that we can see. Let's attack him. So we go here, threatening a fork.
No, the fork gets mate.
He covers the fork. Black's next move.
Well, you've got knight, so... Yeah.
Come on. Other than Bill, Black's next move? Now, we're attacking. We've got three attacking pieces.
Knight D3?
Not knight D3, because the bishop's on it.
Oh, yeah, bishop. Okay.
Look at all checks and captures.
You'll be at C2, but...
No, that's why you're here, to cover C2. Keep looking. This move is going to make your day. Queen takes knight. Bishop takes queen. Thanks for the game, Marcus.
Oh, okay. So, thanks.
14 moves. Okay. Let me put the pieces back. While you digest all of that. Steer the game into a sort of position where you can attack, that's fine. But you have to do what the board is telling you to do. So if it's not an attacking position, you don't attack. You might have to defend, or it might be an end game, something like that. So you must play according to what's on the actual board, not what you want to do. Okay. Well, let's talk about attacking. What sort of things do we need in the position to say, hey, this could be a position where I should attack? What do you need to have a good attack?
Pieces on the board.
I've got plenty of pieces on the board. Anywhere in particular on the board?
I'm pointing at the king.
You're assuming you're attacking the king, but in general, we want more attackers than defenders.
Yeah.
So like if we've got five attackers and you've got three defenders, it's probably going to be a good attack. If we've got one attacker and you've got four defenders, it's going to be a lousy attack. Right, so more pieces, what else do we need?
Like a majority of force that can be applied without a counter-attack coming in faster than our attack.
Yeah, I'm not so much thinking about counter-attacking yet, just in general for what we need to attack. So we've got more pieces, and two more things I'm thinking of.
Superior position.
What about space? If we had more space, does that help us with the attack?
Yeah.
So, why is space good if we want to attack? Say I want to attack him over here, I'm white. I've got a bit more space because I got caught on the fifth.
It fits in with something else that was said earlier.
How does that help me get an attack?
It means you can get more pieces into the attack.
It means it's easier for you to bring more pieces into the area where you want to attack. So I can easily transfer my queenside pieces over to here because I've got heaps of space. But if he wants to transfer his back over here to protect the king, he's a bit more cramped, so it's harder for him. So space is good. And the final thing is, you need to think about what we are attacking. Maybe there needs to be some weakness. So like if his king's castle and his pawn structure is stuffed up like this or something, obvious weakness, he's got every king. If he hasn't got a weakness, maybe we need to do a sacrifice to create a weakness. So that's why we have more pieces. We've got a few spare pieces so we can sacrifice one or two to create a weakness so we can get at it. A lot of my students don't know where to attack. So if we had a position like this, how would we know where to attack?
I know what Guy West says.
What does Guy West say?
Guy West says you attack where the pawns are pointing.
Correct. So our pawns are pointing over here. So white will be attacking on the king side, whereas blacks are pointing here, so black would normally be attacking on the queen side. So if you're not sure, look where you have more space and where your pawns are pointing. Okay.
So that's the generality of attack.
Now, back to how not to attack. I love watching games or playing through games where you have players of different standard. So you have, say, strong player and a less strong player, and you can see what the strong player knows or does that enables him to beat the less strong player. And you can then use that in lessons for your kids and stuff. So what does this guy not understand that the stronger player understands? So today we're going to have a game. Black is Anton Smirnov, who most of you probably know. He's our best junior and international master now, and number 3 or 4 in his age group in the world, even though he's only about 13 or 14. And his opponent is Mr. Illich from New South Wales, who's about 1900 or something good.
Goran Illich, is that the one? Because he's got a son,
I think so.
Too.
Okay, I'm pretty sure
he plays here. Anyway,
he's about 500 points below Anton. And because his surname ends in Ick, he loves attacking. That's my experience anyway with players from Yugoslavia, they're all wild attacking types. Okay, now, let me see. So, Anton is black. Let's see what happens. So it goes G4. Knight out here. Knight C3. Okay. We've only played 2 moves, and I can already tell that white doesn't really understand chess that well. What would make me say that?
Because he broke one of the Purdy rules.
What rule is that?
Is don't block your queen bishop pawn with your queen's knight in opening sit, you don't play pawn to king 4. So that if you're white, that's E4. If you're black, that's E5.
Do you guys understand what Bill said or,
yeah,
or not? But basically, in the opening, you are trying to get 2 pawns side by side. Like in the previous game where Wallace had his 2 pawns side by side, that gives you play. They can either support each other moving forwards, or they can swap off, create an open file, your rooks can get in and so on. So he has blocked his C pawn. That means that if he's going to get 2 pawns side by side, it has to be this pawn. So what is our clever move?
D5.
Yes, we play D5. So now, he can't play this without sacrificing. He can't play this. Whereas we can play C5 when we feel like it. Okay. What did he play? d3. So he's might been going for the Wallace setup from the previous game. Now, White realised his problem, so he played f3. So what's he up to?
Wants to push the e pawn.
He wants to push the e pawn. Gets the pawn play. Get the two pawns side by side. Okay, what do we do?
Can I not do?
No. Don't speak unless you're spoken to. What do we do? Do we do our own thing? Do we try and stop it?
Bishop to b5.
Bishop to b4. Correct. So queen pin is nice. So again, stopping this.
And developing a piece and preparing.
And developing a piece and all that sort of stuff. Now, he plays pawn here. Is that a good move? Right move? Okay move?
It's alright.
What do you reckon, Bill?
I reckon it was the tempo.
Yeah. You've got to ask yourself, why does the bishop go here? If it's gone here, it's pretty much saying, I'm prepared to take this knight. Double your pawns. So, we're spending a move forcing him to do what he probably wants to do anyway. Waste of time. You're playing e3 or something like that. Alright, so we're going to chop, chop. I think he just castled from memory. Alright. Like the play, what should he do?
Push the e pawn.
Push the e pawn, but we've got covered twice, so you'll be dropping
the
pawn.
Push just one square, is
it? You push it just one square, yep, yep. That looks like the obvious move. But Mr. Lick woke up in the morning, he was feeling good about himself, the sun was shining. So he played g4. Because he wants to attack. Are we terrified?
No.
Probably not. What do we do? Actually, his next move is a bit interesting. See if he can guess his next move. We've got probably three or four quite good moves.
Probably be playing c5.
C5 looks like the obvious sort of a move. Didn't play c5.
I give consideration to h6.
H6, okay. Tell me why you want to play h6.
I said I'd give consideration.
Alright, tell me why you're considering
h6. The things I'm thinking of is it gives a square for the knight to run away to h7, which is not great, but
right.
It might not be a disaster. But it starts to open that diagonal from d8 to h4, and the king, white king has not castled.
Yeah, I think his next one is going to be here. One thing we have to be careful of, if someone is attacking us, we don't want to give them a target. So these pawns here, that's all pretty cool. If one of them gets attacked, we can move it. But if we move this up, it might look okay, but it's going to make it a lot easier for him to push this, and then we've got a take, or he might even line up the queen and do a sacrifice, something like that. So I don't know that it's necessary to do that, because if my knight's attacked, I'm not going to retreat it here. I'm either going to put it here, or here, or here, I'm thinking. Any other idea for black?
There's a few ideas.
I'll give you a hint. So, because he's throwing his pawns at us, and because his queen side's a mess, that means his king's probably going to be stuck here, isn't it? So how could we exploit that? Potentially. Not a lot. Bill, you want to have a go?
Well, you could play for e5 at some point, open the e-file.
So what move would you play?
Let's see. Maybe knight to c6.
Knight c6? Blocking your c-pawn? Cecil Purdy would be turning in his grave, Bill.
But you're going to play e5, so...
Yeah, probably, yeah.
Another idea, the slower idea is b6, and maybe bring the bishop back to a6 or something.
Okay.
But I kind of like a bit more dynamic here. Mm-hmm.
So what would you do?
Maybe knight to e6 if he kicks the other knight and come back to d7 and play for e5.
Sorry, knight to where?
Knight to e6. Oh, if he kicks the other knight, we can come back to d7.
Yeah. Right, he didn't do that. He played rook here. So normally it wouldn't be the rook's turn to move. Normally we'd be getting out these smaller bits first. But you'll notice the rook is on the same line as the king, and as Bill has pointed out, if at some stage we can get an e5, that's going to be pretty cool for black. Okay, I'm guessing he played h4 here. Let me just check. No, he didn't actually. He played e3. Sort of developing move. Okay, so now we go c5. So it looks like it's losing a pawn, but if we were to take this pawn, A, that frees us up to play this move if we want, or B, queen come out here with a double attack on these two pawns, so it'll be pretty terrible. So, white played bishop. Good move? Bad move? Average move?
It's alright.
It's alright? What do you like about it? What's alright about it?
Bishop's on a good square.
Bishop's attacking the rook?
Yeah.
Good attack? Bad attack?
It's good.
Okay, so I put my bishop here. You want to swap bishops?
No.
Why not?
Black bishop's bad.
Yep. So are you going to move it again and retreat?
Mm-hmm.
You've just wasted two moves. Yes, so this is the third bad move. We don't want to swap our good bishop, because our pawns are dark squares, this is a good bishop, for his bad bishop. And also, when we take, he recaptures with developing move. So we've got rid of his bad bishop, given him a free move. Just for the sake of threatening a rook.
You've lost the two bishops as well.
Lost the two bishops as well. So that was really a poor decision. Okay, but we're not worried. We have our attack. He's got the two pawns side by side. He's gaining space on the king side. But does he have more attackers than defenders? Does he have a weakness he's attacking? Don't think so. Looking like a bad attack. Right, how do we respond? What do we do? Think back to the Wallace game a minute ago.
It's a white's move.
White just went here, so it's black's go. So in the previous game, Marcus was trying hard to attack on the flank. So we did a counter-attack in the centre. So our good move is?
Exchanging with the d4.
Why do you want to do that? What do you gain from the swap?
When the pawn, e-pawn exchange with the d5, so we can bring up the
pawn. Well, what if I take with the c-pawn, because I don't want my double pawn?
Yeah.
Is that a good trade for you?
It helps to open up that file, e5.
It opens this up a bit, but still, you've got rid of my bad double pawn. Alright, not that, but close, even else.
E5?
Yes. The best response to a flank attack, counter-attack in the centre. And that's why we put our rook there, so it's all working beautifully. Okay, we took. We take. Would you believe he took again? He's only got one piece developed. And we recaptured with developing move, so that doesn't look overly brilliant to me. And we're threatening the pawn. So, white's brilliant attack. We've played 13 moves. How many pieces has he got developed? None. All he's got is totally stuffed up pawn structure. It's pretty terrible. All right, so we're attacking the pawn. He comes here to defend the pawn. What's our next move?
Queen e7.
e7? Is that the best spot?
Knight takes g4.
Right, why do you want to play knight takes g4?
So we can bring the queen into attack.
Right, so you're giving up knight for pawn, so you've lost 3 points for 1 point. You get a check. And you have a good follow-up.
We can bring the queen to f6.
Yep. So I'll go and hide. Maybe I'll hide here. Or
bring the
queen. Take that pawn.
Knight out. Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it's not a good attack. Again, see, we've got two attackers. He's got queen and knight.
Oh,
and
yeah, it's not a good idea.
But it's good to look at checks and captures like that. watching this game live, and I was thinking queen here was the move to build up on this chap. And I asked my computer what it thought about it, and it was started to be attacking the knight, attacking the rook, and then queen took the pawn or something, and it wasn't happy. So both Anton and my computer wanted black to go there.
Oh, okay. That was Charles' move.
So, why is he putting his queen there? What's he doing? Threatening something?
Just piling up on that
pawn.
Yes.
Yeah.
One of the things we need to do is identify weaknesses in the opponent's camp. So this pawn is obviously the key weakness at the moment, only defended by the king. So now we're attacking it twice. I think he played queen d2. Queen e7, queen d2. Alright. Our next move is pretty obvious.
Yep,
the
other
rookie.
Eight.
Bring the other rookie.
Start
I say to all my students, if you don't know what to do, find your worst place piece. That's not helping you. Would you like to see this one? And put on the best square.
No, well, the From Chess Made Easy by Cecil Bird.
Sounds like a good book. I must buy it sometime. Rook e8. Alright, three times we're attacking it. He defends it. Okay, how are we going? How's got all Anton going? He's got his pieces all developed, they're all on nice looking squares. Got the two pawns side by side, he's got more space, his king's safe. He's identified a weakness, he's built up on it. But he hasn't won. His opponent's defended everything. And in fact, this position is the main reason I chose this game as a lesson game. This is where chess gets a little bit hard. What should black play here? The hard part about chess is when everything's okay in the right spot and it looks good, what do you do? What do you do when you don't know what to do? Anyone got some ideas?
Well, that knight takes g4 needs re-examination.
Alright, so knight takes, pawn takes, move the follow-up.
Queen takes, no, no, can't because
it'll be. No, the rook's on it, so it's probably a knight down.
So it can only be queen to.
Pushing the pawn to d4.
Pushing the pawn here?
Yeah.
Why do you like that one?
So, when c4 exchange.
C4 takes, right?
Yeah, and c4 takes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so now.
Let's say I take with the queen.
Yeah. You can take the queen.
No, you can take here if you want.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But it's still two pawns for two pawns.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You've still got an okay game, but it didn't sort of give him out of hand.
Oh, I thought that was a queen.
When it's not right. What can we do? Do we play a high class waiting move? Some of my students, when they don't know what to do, they play that.
Ian Rogers type move.
They have their opponent self destructs.
Oh, I've got an idea.
Bill, do you want to hit us with an idea?
Okay, gains the space on the queen side, b5. The idea is to play b4 at some point, then d4 maybe.
B5, alright, so you're gaining space, attacking a bit on the queen side?
Another idea is to attack that a3 pawn.
Alright, want to play c4 or something?
No, I'm not sure I want to play c4, maybe even get a piece onto the a5, but c4 sort of gives up the d4 square. It might be alright, but.
So you're changing your focus from over here to the weaknesses over here.
That's one idea. Another idea is to prepare d4.
Prepare b4.
D4.
D4, that's right.
Look behind it or something.
I haven't got much to do. I've probably got to play knight out here to here or something.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that. Cause
hope I hang on.
Why can always exchange and play e4 and sort of block it up a bit.
Okay.
So,
anyone like those ideas or got different ideas? I think Anton played a pretty good move here. Probably takes a pretty strong player to play. Alright. I've shown this to lots of my classes. Now, the first thing they say, pawn here! We do a few swaps and it looks all good. Then if I say that's not the greatest, they go, oh, knight takes here! Loses knight for pawn, that's not the greatest. So they say, alright, knight here, this must be the winning move. But unfortunately, that loses a knight.
Oh, there's another plan too. Get the knight on c4.
Right, hang on. So one of my students in active sheer desperation played the killer move, look here, saying, please take me, please take me, so I can fork your pool in my knife. Of course, it's not threatening to just ignore it. But as I said in my lesson last month, what you should be thinking about if you're a good player is, where do you want your pieces? Not so much what can I threaten, but where do you want your pieces? So we've ganged up on this pawn three times, he's defended it three times. Is there any piece that's not helping us, or could be better placed somewhere else?
Yeah, the knight. Yeah, so
yes, so the knight. The knight's, well, we looked at the sacrifice of the knight, it didn't help. Right, so I give the knight to my students to say, what square do you want to put this knight on? Bill's already worked it out.
And C4.
Yes, there's a hole here. Now, if we were able to get our knight here, we're not only hitting his queen, but we're hitting this four times. What a brilliant plan. So Anton's move, this knight here. So he begins to think, oh, that was at a good spot, and you're moving backwards, what's going on? But if you think, where do I want my pieces? Then it's going to go here, and it's going to go here. He's in a bit of strife. All right, so white panicked a little bit. Tried to distract Anton, saying, take me.
But maybe knight h3 might be worth a go.
Knight who?
Knight to h3.
Maybe, but I mean, it's still a good plan for Anton. Anyway, he did this, hoping we can take and maybe we can play pawn here and it's not a weakness anymore. Anton said, all right, I'm not going to be distracted. White took. Anton said, okay, I'm still not going to be distracted. I'm going to come down here. So now I'm attacking it four times. You're only defending it three. So white's still in distract mode. It's a pretty tricky player. And he says, take me. Please take me. I've got to get rid of this pressure somehow off my e-pawn. Should we take or not take?
Take it with the knight.
It can take and come back to the position.
Take it with the knight, and you can play a knight up here, maybe?
Yeah. Come back to the same post. Same square.
Mm. Anyway, Anton said, okay, I'm not going to give you any play. I'm going to block it. Now I'm still attacking your queen. And so, alright. I think he played queen d3. Anton took the pawn. So he's broken through the weak point. Is he threatening anything?
Yes, threatening to win the rook.
By?
And then knight times 3-4.
Yes, yes. So we've got to be careful. He's threatening knight takes pawn check, bringing the rook down here. So we play this. Anton's next move. How can we keep the attack going? But our knights and rooks in a pretty good spot. Another single threatening move. So whilst looking around at the remnants of his position, is there much he can do, or is it all pretty terrible? So he decided, all right, I'll do a sacrifice. Takes. So he's given up queen for rook and knight. But what can we do next? It's finish him off. Bill?
Well, it was an obvious move, but...
Black's move, yeah, obvious move.
Capture the loose pawn on
A3. Free pawn over here. That's £1 million plans. King E4. They play the queen here. Knight, I think. Queen takes pawn check. King here. Let's push the pass here. Knight here. Check. King here. Pawn here. And the game. So, pretty impressive game from Anton. How was White's attack? G4, H4?
It didn't get there.
It didn't get there. It was a load of rubbish. He didn't have more space. He didn't have more pieces. He didn't have a weakness. He just attacked because he wanted to. And Anton responded correctly, putting his pieces on good squares like Wallace did, counter-attacking in the centre, identifying weakness, building up. And then the key lovely move, the knight manoeuvre back here, because he's thinking, where do I want my pieces? Not so much, what can I do for a one-move type threat? Okay. Any questions? Hopefully you know a little bit better how not to attack, and you won't throw your G-pawn, your H-pawn, or your opponents unless you have good cause. Okay, press the off button, end of lesson. Thank you very much.